Hello, my name is Stephen Perini. I'm a research assistant here at Penn State's Electrical Characterization Lab. I'm going to give a brief overview of dielectric characterization of materials at microwave frequencies. So where do microwave frequency measurements fit into the electromagnetic spectrum? Here we see a frequency axis from DC all the way up to petahertz, which is 10 to the power of the 15. The wavelength at each frequency is given below the frequency number. And we can see that as frequency increases, wavelengths become smaller and smaller. Because of the diminishing wavelength in the megahertz and gigahertz range, common impedance analysis techniques that are performed at lower frequencies are no longer applicable. For the frequency ranges of interest, which also include, by the way, bands for 5G communication, vector network analysis is used. A vector network analyzer measures the ratios of the reflected and transmitted signal to the incident signal across a frequency sweep. We look at analogy from a light wave striking an optical lens, we see some of the light is reflected and some transmitted. The properties of the lens, basically maybe how opaque it is, will determine how much light would be reflected or transmitted. And we could characterize a lens by those ratios. This same concept is used in RF signals, except electromagnetic energy is in the RF range instead of the optical range. Here we see one of our vector network analyzers with a device, this in this case a waveguide, connected to its ports, and it's measuring the reflected and transmitted power. The dielectric properties we measure are predominantly the permittivity or dielectric constant and the loss. The permeability is the ability of a material to polarize under the influence of an electric field. Permittivity is generally designated as epsilon R or epsilon prime R. And that is defined as the ratio of the capacitance of a capacitor with a material as its dielectric to its capacitance with a vacuum as its dielectric. The higher the dielectric constant, we can see the higher the capacitance will be. Dielectric loss is the energy loss divided by the energy stored over a charge-discharge cycle. The inverse of that is Q, and often at high frequencies, the Q value is given as opposed to the loss value. We also have some capabilities to measure permeability, a magnetic property of material, and resistivity. It's important to characterize materials across a broad frequency spectrum since the dielectric properties of the material change due to different dielectric relaxation mechanisms such as space charge, dipolar, the ionic, and electronic relaxations. This generalized graph shows a decrease in permittivity, designated as epsilon prime, and the increase in loss, designated as epsilon double prime, across the frequency band due to the relaxation mechanisms. Now, different materials will have these relaxation mechanisms occur at different frequencies, maybe even much greater than what this generic plot suggests. But in the microwave and millimeter wave frequencies, we see that the tails of both the dipolar and the phonon modes will influence the material's dielectric properties. For characterization measurements in the microwave frequency range, there's not one technique, but many to cover the frequency spectrum. Here we see a list of the various techniques available in our labs and the respective measurement frequency range that they cover. Often the technique selected is based on the constraints of sample fabrication, its geometry, or the measurement frequency requested. But in some cases, depending on these restraints, a specific measurement frequency may not be attainable, or possibly the material dielectric properties prevent a certain technique from being used. Let's look at these techniques a little closer. The split cavity and resonant post measurements are resonant techniques. These are ideal for either flat, thin samples, or a disc or a puck shaped samples. These are accurate techniques, but provide data at only a single frequency depending on the material property and the dimensions, although varying the dimensions can vary the measurement frequency slightly. Here we see a typical transmission suite of that the network analyzer would have for one of these techniques. The x-axis is the frequency span from 2 to 24 gigahertz, and the y-axis shows the power transmitted in decibels. We see a number of resonant peaks across the frequency range, and depending on the technique used, we would look at a specific resonance. And from that specific resonance, we would find the center frequency and the 3 dB, or it's called the half power bandwidth. And from those parameters, we can determine the material's permittivity and its Q value. Transmission and reflection measurement techniques. They're a broadband. They measure over a range of frequencies, and they include waveguides, coaxial fixtures like a liquid probe, and this 3 millimeter coaxial measurement, and also microstrips and coplanar waveguides and substrates. Generally, these techniques require additional time to calibrate the system prior to the measurement taking place. And in case of waveguides, a sample must precisely fit into the waveguide cavity, which may require additional machining or sample preparation. The microstrip technique covers a broad frequency range, and in our labs, we have the capability to measure very small patterns at high frequencies using coplanar probes made by Cascade or Form Factor now, and their corresponding probe stations. Two techniques we just obtained in the second half of 2019 are the open resonator and the Swiss to 12 material characterization kit. The open resonator is a hybrid resonant technique. It measures multiple resonance of the sample across a frequency range. This fixture goes from 12 to 67 gigahertz. Okay, it has very good accuracy, but the sample must be somewhat large, 10 to 11 centimeters square, and it must be perfectly flat and relatively thin, maybe only a few millimeters. The Swiss to 12 is our highest frequency measurement tool. It goes up to 110 gigahertz, from 67 gigahertz to 110. And the sample size is smaller, which is convenient, though it should be a few millimeters thick, okay? And also the Swiss to 12 requires the most setup time of all the techniques we have. So which technique should you use? Well, once again, it depends on the number of variables. Each technique has advantages and disadvantages, such as accuracy, ease of measurement, time, cost, frequency range. All these things have to be taken into consideration. For the techniques listed here, I've shown the pros in blue and the cons in red. And we have additional techniques that I didn't even put into that slide. That's why we always recommend having a consultation with our technical staff to discuss measurement specifics for your sample and determine the test plan that would best fit your needs. Hopefully this presentation gave you an introductory understanding of dielectric measurement in the microwave frequency range and the techniques that are available here at Penn State's Electrical Characterization Lab. For additional information, please contact us using the Material Characterization Lab website. Thank you.